Now I request none other than our master urologist, Dr. C. Mallikarjun, to briefly talk about these complications and how to overcome them.
Thank you, Chairman. The biggest complication is asking to talk on complications in 10 minutes. Am I right? I think that's the thing. But anyway, thank you, and thanks Chandramohan and PT Hospital for giving me this opportunity to be in front of you today. Let me come to the thing straight. This has been a workshop on RIRS versus mini PERC. Well, we come to the points of complications, overall complications, but in specific we discuss whether the tract size really matters. So the major complications are so and so, like what has been written there, because it's a semi-blind or a guided procedure. And this is one of the beautiful pictures I can ever see in the net, is one of the drainage coming get into the renal vein and going onto the IVC. Well, that's a thing which I never want to see it, in fact. Anyway, predisposing factors for bleeding are, these are wonderful articles coming from both SGPGI and NIDIAD, which shows multiple punctures, stone burden. You all know about this. Stone burden, probably parenchymal thickness, and third one is being said as tract size as a reason for predisposing factor for bleeding. So let us look at the tract size in some detail. Where all can be the bleeding? If you look into the way the needle goes into the calyx, if perfectly done, where all can be the bleeding? This is interlobular arteries, these are arcuate arteries, this is interlobar arteries, lobar artery, and segmental artery. So all these places, at five places, it can be in an injury. We're not talking about the veins, which are not the major reason of the bleeding. So it can happen in any of these five areas. Let us look one by one. If you have an arcuate artery or interlobular artery, which are most commonly injured in majority of these things because you share the parenchyma there, it is mostly amplage and nephrostomy tamponade itself can stop the bleeding and you can go ahead with the procedure without any problem. An interlobar or a lobar vessel happening, sometimes you may get away with an amplage sheath getting tamponaded it, but there will be a significant hematuria or you may just stop the procedure and come back. But in a segmental vessel, if there is an injury of a segmental vessel somewhere at this point, there will be progression is difficult, either hematuria or a big lump in the renal fossa is going to happen. So don't put all bleedings in one basket and say bleeding, bleeding, bleeding. You should analyze where all can be the bleeding, then only you will understand the management perspectives and what can happen in the near future. Will mini or mega makes a difference? That's a big thing. Because in the mindset of the urologist, it feels that a mini PERC will have a less bleeding. It's not at all so. Parenchymal bleeding, which happens because of the arcuate or interlobular vessels, is either in mini or mega. It doesn't make any difference because it is well controllable unless there is a lot of talk. But infundibular injury, puncture and dilatation, bleeding can be more in mega PERC, but it can be there in mini PERC. But the problem you should understand in mini PERC is the progression cannot happen with bleeding in mini PERC, but the same progression can be possible in mega. So you have two things which can happen. Either bleeding, if it is even minimal, the difficulty of progression in mini PERC is going to be there. Bleeding is a little more, but still mega PERC, you can complete the procedure and come back. So you need to keep a balance about these two things. So it is basically bleeding is related to puncture and dilatation, not on the tract size alone. Perfect puncture, mini or mega, there is hardly any clinical significant bleeding versus transmission rates, whereas imperfect puncture, severity may be more in mega, but hamper stone clearance in a mini PERC. This has to be understood. It doesn't percolate all the time saying that mini PERC doesn't have a bleeding, only mega PERC has a bleeding. You can have 100 reasons why a bleeding can happen, because parenchyma has not been tamponaded like this. You put the amplage back into the calyx and see that the bleeding stops once it goes into the calyx and the complete tamponade happens. This is a parenchymal bleeding, which is not a problem. But see this. This is a different thing wherein. Okay, this is different. Now, this is a different thing wherein you see that. You see the progression of the thing. You are dilating it. Okay, you have dilated it. See that. That's it. It has gone beyond the parenchyma. That's it. You have gone beyond the parenchyma. There is no mini or mega. Tract size doesn't make any difference here. It's going to bleed whether it's mini or mega because you injured the parenchyma on the other side and it continues to bleed. See this? This is the hole in the parenchyma. That may be a mini or a mega PERC. It continues to bleed. So this has to be remembered. And bleeding intra-op, majority of the times, if it is parenchymal, you can get away with many of things. And you may not need all these maneuvers unless otherwise you have majorly injured an interlobular or an interlobar vessel, which is the thing. And none of these things will really help to do a gluing or any coagulation on the table. Know when to stop. That is going to be the bottom line. Coming to intraoperative bleeding, which you can see it's the most frightening situation. You have so many things which can come out, but one thing I would always insist on is evacuate the bladder clots. There are some clots which have already happened inside the bladder. Be sure that you evacuate the bladder clots. Restol is in your brain all the time. Continuation of intraoperative bleeding in the postoperative period, either while rooming PCN or a dislodgement of the clot or an infected urine can happen, but majority of the time they do settle off with a conservative or a supportive management. But these are the problems which can be seen in some places wherein you have a simple stone bit where you underwent a mini perk and you ultimately have a large perinephric hematoma that can happen. So don't expect that the bleeding happens only inside the system. It can happen outside the system also. See, this is a large perinephric hematoma happening it, or otherwise it can happen in a subcapsular way also. See that there's a big subcapsular hematoma in a small kidney happening, which may require drainage definitely, because this kidney will have a Page effect and may lose its function if it is going to happen. See this amount of hematoma, and you see the kidney which is completely compressed across onto them. No, that's not the thing. That's the old one, and this is the new one. This is a subcapsular hematoma. You have a pleural effusion here, and you have an hematoma which is appearing here, and then you will have a Page effect of the kidney, and completely kidney is compressed because of a large hematoma. So these things may need to be drained. That has to be understood. So delayed bleeding. Everybody is bothered about bleeding. If at all it is, it's only the delayed bleeding. That is, which happens after the 7th day or 8th day. How many times we are really bothered about the bleeding which happened on the table? You may stop the procedure, you may come out, but majority of the times it is a delayed bleeding which happens, and thus tract size makes a difference here. I'll give you a simple example. This is a nice upper calycel and upper lower calycel stones, both of 2 centimeters in size, and I did a bilateral mini perk on both the issues, and massive hematuria on the day 1, clot evacuation done twice, and the stent came out during the prime. And do an angiogram, you see what happened. You have an AV fistula in the top and you have a pseudoaneurysm below. So it doesn't matter any difference whether you do a mini perk or a mega perk. It doesn't make any difference. These are independent of the size of the tract. They are independent of the size of the tract, and majority of the times either a pseudoaneurysm or AV fistula, or sometimes, unfortunately, 10% of the times you may not see any of the things happening there. So higher incidence in upper pole tracts. And you know all the things. You have a talk also about how it's going to be done. Whenever there is a hemodynamic instability, repeated clot evacuations, blood transmissions. In our institute, if he requires 1 clot evacuation with 100 or 200 ml clots in the bladder, this requires an angiogram. There is no other chance. So anyway, angioembolization is the treatment of the choice, and management of the bleeding per se by surgery is a rare event now, with angioembolization being available. Occasionally, there are patients who are being resorted to nephrectomy, but partial nephrectomy at that point of time appears to be a tedious or a time-consuming or a experience-related surgery. So ultimately, the bottom line you need to say when you talk about this delayed bleeding, is there any difference in the incidence between the mini and mega? There is nothing. Even a simple renal biopsy with a needle of an 18 gauge can produce bleeding. So whether you do a mega or a mini, of this angioembolization or a delayed bleeding which can happen is going to be the same. So don't get carried away with the intention that mini perk will not have a problems later. So prevent bleeding. All the factors, you all know what has to be done. Careful puncture and dilatation. Coming to the rest of the things on organ injury, liver, spleen, lung, pleura, and colon. Well, liver and spleen most of the time don't happen unless there is a hepatosplenomegaly. So when you find a hepatosplenomegaly in any of these situations, think about doing it under ultrasound guidance and see that it is, see the splenomegaly here or hepatomegaly here, see that the puncture is done on ultrasound without going through the spleen. Organ injury to the lung or pleura. Lung is rare, pleura is the most common. Simple answer, if you have a mid-scapular line in a prone position, if you stay lateral to it in this intercostal space, that is above, between the 12th and the 11th rib, you're not going to injure the pleura. But if you go above it, you'll definitely injure the pleura, but you'll not injure the lung in an expiratory phase. So if you are here in between, you go stay on the lateral part of the mid-scapular line. If it's above it or between 10th and 11th, you are going to go through the pleura, but you're not going to injure the lung if you're doing it in expiratory phase. So what you do ultimately, supracostal, PCN tube for 48 to 72 hours in case if it is through the pleura, let the tract form and you can take it out. But try to understand, majority of the pleural effusions which happen after the pleural injury happen after 72 hours to 4 days. They don't happen on day 1 or a day 2. After all catheters are removed, then only they come back with pleural effusion, and majority of the times they can be just managed with aspiration alone, not a tube. Retrorenal colon, it's an overrated situation, and majority of the times you are unlucky to happen. Whatever attempts you do it on the table to identify that probably will may produce more injuries rather than less injuries. It doesn't matter whether it's a supine or prone, it happens to be the same, and in fact it is more in a prone patients it seems. Supine patients doesn't mean that colonic injury is more. You staying behind the posterior axial line or medial to the posterior axial line is the only way to prevent the colon. And you all know the treatment of colonic injury. Put back the nephrostomy into the colon, make it an extraperitoneal drainage, and intraperitoneal perforation of the colon is a very rare event in PCML. So whether it is a mini perk or a mega perk, the treatment is going to be the same in a colonic injury. I will stop this. I think you all know how to manage a PCS injury during the surgeries, and I invite you for this event coming up in September on Stone at INU on 6th and 7th of September, which is the whole details are available on our website. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Sir, thank you for an excellent exposition. I just have one question. What is the surgeon factor in this? Some of these complications depend on the way.
Of course, I have written that. Surgeon experience is one of the factors which I have written.
Yes, some of these will happen because of the way we plan access.
Yes, absolutely.
That is one part. The second part I want you to elaborate upon is, why is that when we have specialized surgeons for reconstructive surgery, we have specialization for andrology, why do we think that something like PCNL or something like endourology should be done by everybody and not have specialization for it?
Because that is bread and butter.
Are we trying to dumb down endourology?
Of course,
which it's not.
Yeah, of course, all the specializations are the cream on the butter, on the bread, but the bread is going to be the same for everybody.
So about surgeon experience, would you like to elaborate?
No, that's exactly what I'm saying. Everybody wants to eat an ice cream, whether it's a butterscotch, vanilla or anything, it's your choice. The question is, that is how the specialization, but eating a bread is always a necessity and the rest of the cream as a specialty, because 50% or 60% of the load of a urologist present day is an endourological or a stone disease. That's the reason why everybody wants to do that.
Then should we not try to train people better that is going to be the major part.
There are two aspects into it. One is the training part, and number two is the attitude of the person, and number three is going to be the experience. All three cannot be judged by us, and all three cannot be achieved by sitting us and discussing it also. So there are three parts. One is training, whether it's happened or not, attitude for the person to learn about it, and number three is how much amount of workload he does, which makes him better.
Sir, would you recommend in all the cases, like we talked about splenic and colonic injury, better always do a CT scan, not go straight forward with the IVP, because most of the colonic injury reported are the cases where only IVP was done and CT was not done.
Aditya, I have a little differ here. You see, here we see three generations of people sitting here. People who have done PCNL 30 years ago, they're sitting in the front row. People who have done PCNL 20 years ago, and people who have started last 10 years. The people who have started 30 years ago never saw a CT scan before they did a PCNL. People who have done 10 years, past 10 years, know about a CT scan. So we never saw colon through a imaging. That is what is the primary thing what I've been conveying it of. So imaging has started off late and started understanding that this imaging may help in preventing a colonic injury. People have done PCNL without imaging help. People have done PCNL with imaging help. The incidence of colonic injuries have not decreased or increased at that point of time. So understanding the anatomy, basic principles to sticking to the principles and surface markings probably is the only way to prevent a colonic injury.
Sir, retrorenal colon particularly is the issue because it cannot be diagnosed. And most of the papers which are largest series, they say retrorenal colon was the issue which wasn't diagnosed without doing a CT scan.
After CT scan, also, how many times, just take a thing, how many times people see a colon when they see a CT scan? They are done with after seeing the stone, and they start talking to the patient about the costing of the stone removal.
Sir,
how many times did you see a colon in the thing? So Paul sees the colon all the time on the X-ray, on the floor, but I can't see that on the floor. I don't know why. I never saw the colon on the floor.
Sir, we are running.
And the colon keeps changing its position.
That's the reason why nobody sees.
That's Paul, probably sir, the reason I would say.
Just allow me one question, please.
Sir, since really we are 2000, running short of time. You can ask him personally in the lunch session, sir.
Very, very important point he should make is that since 2000, mini PCNL has come, whole literature says the only difference between mini and a mega PCNL is amount of bleeding. Stone clearance, time taken, everything remains the same complications. The only difference between mini and mega established is bleeding.
Point taken.
Just one observation.
No.
All I say is that I am very happy that I have one person who agrees with me that all these complications of bleeding is depends upon not the size of the tract, but it is the initial puncture.
That's it.
I am very, very happy. We go right up to 36 French. Now 36 French dilators access sheath is not available by Cook. That's the reason why we don't. We do routinely 30, 32 today. So we have no increased bleeding complications at all. We do have, but not that much like what you are being exposed, as if that larger the tract, larger the bleeding point.
Definitely no. The surgeon's experience.
The last line I would say, all the data is not related to the delayed bleeding. All the data is related to the intra bleeding and the drop in the hemoglobin. And every data says it is not clinically significant to hamper the patient's outcomes. That is the thing what you need to understand.
Okay, sir. Thank you for your session, sir.